Hey there, this is Jean Tiberio, and I'm a nutritionist and a wellness coach. Welcome to Healing Outside the Box. Today we have episode 261, which is, how can we reduce climate change with our diet? Now folks, there's been a lot of talk around the water cooler about what foods we could eat or not eat for sustainability or slowing down the progression of climate change. And I've got good news because there are things we can do. There was an article in The Guardian recently, and it got me to thinking, how can we translate that awareness about the need to eat sustainable food into breakfast, lunch, and dinner? Can we really help our planet by eating more from column A and less from column B? Let's discuss. The article in The Guardian was called, Eat This to Save the World! Exclamation point. I'm not sure if they need the exclamation point, but there you have it. I'll give you a link to the article in the show notes. So we are talking here about the entire process of growing food sustainably. Now, food production is responsible for about 25% of greenhouse gases. And that's not even counting trucks, jets, and the fuel that they use. But food production includes a lot of things, like how much irrigation water they need, how many trees are being cut down to graze the cattle, what fertilizers, pesticides, or herbicides they use, where does the runoff from those chemical fertilizers go to, how fast the plant or animal grows. In other words, it takes more energy to grow cattle than chickens. And it takes more water to grow avocado and almonds. How fast the plant or animal grows. And how much waste is produced. Not only the rotting food, but the carcasses from the cattle and pigs. And it is a little more complicated than just good versus bad. Because almonds, which are good for you, require much more irrigation water than animals drink. Beef cattle, on the other hand, require the cutting down of forests, which will then no longer be able to grab the CO2. In addition, we really can't get around the fact that it is just inhumane to lock animals up without the ability to even move around. And as we know, they take away their newborn babies, which we wouldn't like very much. And they're suffering with diseases because we're feeding cheap corn to animals that graze on grass. So it's complicated. What's maybe good for us is not always good for the planet. But there are ways that we can basically do the best we can. And in my opinion, we can focus more on eating plants and buying local food, and with as many organic items as you can afford. And what we can also do might include composting and maybe growing some produce on our own, either in our backyard or a porch or maybe a community garden. And there is plenty of help out there if you are just starting out and need some assistance. This Guardian article states that the U.S. will publish its national food strategy in July. And I will look into it when it comes out and give you an update. They will be asking the experts, and they promise to give us the 411 on which foods have how much impact on our environment. Now, for all foods, a good rule of thumb is to try to limit how much the food has to travel by plane, train, or truck. So basically, we're talking in this country, hopefully, and as close to your state as possible. And yes, I know there are some exceptions, like pineapple and bananas, which don't grow very well in Massachusetts. But overall, the trend will be to focus on how we can grow and consume more produce locally. Another source of information is a podcast put out by two women, and it's called Research, I'll give you a link to it in the show notes. Okay, let's run through some of the food that we're talking about. Number one, locally grown vegetables. No surprise here. We're talking about any vegetables. Fresh, frozen, pickled. Given the fact that June is indeed busting out all over, I thought I'd start with this one. That song comes from a musical called Carousel, which didn't age well. Now, in terms of flavor for produce, the fresher the better. In terms of vitamins, the frozen come pretty close. Flavor compounds deteriorate with age. So the best possible scenario for produce is to pick them and eat them within 24 to 48 hours. As I've mentioned, when it comes to cutting down on greenhouse gases, the closer to home the better. Due to their high water content, produce can be heavy, which means it costs more to ship. July, August, and September are peak times to visit your local farmer's market. There's also community gardens, which would be great if you have kids that are still too young to roll their eyes when you mention it. Remember, if they get a chance at a young age to have that experience of remembering what it is like to pick something off the vine and eat it, that's what they'll remember. And that might help motivate them later in life. There's also delivery services sprouting up that utilize produce that don't look perfect. And they sell them and deliver them to your door for less than half the price. One of these companies that sells oddly shaped vegetables is called Misfits Market, and I belong to that. They will ship a ton of produce to me for $30. These places are usually free to join, and you can just tap or click to order the vegetables and fruits that you want delivered. With these companies, you can order every week or every other week. And I think with some of them, you can just ignore them if you don't want any deliveries for a while. They do run out of certain produce, but there's a lot to choose from. And if you make the $30 minimum, the delivery is free, and you just have to tip the driver. Between Misfits and my farmer's market, I usually don't have to get much produce at the grocery store in the summer months. And if you want to save even more money and like sprouts or microgreens, you can buy the seeds on Amazon and sprout them with water. So if you buy your produce in season during the warm months, you will be getting less off-season produce from places like Chile or New Zealand. And that, of course, saves fuel and additional charges for shipping. Number two on the list is grass-fed beef and lamb. Now, in general, focusing on eating mostly plants is good for the planet, but it might be unrealistic to suggest that we will all go vegan anytime soon. Vegan diets can decrease greenhouse gases from agriculture up to 80%, but lacto-ovo-vegetarians can save about 75% on greenhouse gases, so there's not much difference there. What we've excluded is beef and pork. So we can milk the cow or raise hens for eggs without killing the animal, which creates a problem with biological waste and runoff from the biological waste and methane gas from cattle belching, etc. The flip side to feeding the planet with a vegetarian diet is that produce uses a lot of irrigation water. If we can clean up the wastewater and reuse it, that might take care of that problem. But most would agree that there is a place for sustainably raising livestock. And humanely, of course. There's an NIH article about this, and I'll put it in the show notes. What they are talking about in this article is regenerative agriculture. A little like in the old days. And this combines raising livestock and growing crops on the same farm. This allows the farmer to use the manure from the animals, which they had been doing in the old days, to fertilize his plants on that lot during the next season. The goal is to avoid artificial, and now we know, possibly dangerous, chemical fertilizers. I've always had a bee in my bonnet about using liquid anhydrous ammonia to fertilize crops on industrial farms. This product comes from ammonium nitrate, which was used for bomb materials during World War II. It was also Timothy McVeigh's weapon of choice in Oklahoma City. This liquid anhydrous ammonia reduces organic matter in the soil because it kills worms and microorganisms that make all those flavor compounds and vitamins. So, consumed in moderation, meat can provide high-quality protein, folate, and B12, which are somewhat limiting in plants. As someone once said somewhere, the next best thing to being a vegetarian is eating a vegetarian. Animals, of course. I suppose you could put venison in this category as well, or even elk if you happen to live in Maine. Those animals are nutrient-rich and lower in fat than cattle or pigs. These grazes use grasses and forage for plants that humans cannot utilize. Okay, number three is oats. I am placing oats in the protein category because I feel like oats can be a great source of protein, as well as soluble fiber and lots of B vitamins. If the oats are grown without artificial chemical fertilizers or herbicides, oats can be a great source of nutrients for breakfast, lunch, and desserts. Oats can grow at high altitudes and can be a good crop to alternate with other crops. In addition to having the vitamins and minerals of other whole grains, the soluble fiber makes it helpful to lower cholesterol and blood sugar. You can get non-GMO or organic oatmeal for not too much money. Okay, number four. Mussels, clams, oysters, and scallops. Now, these guys as a group are called bivalves, and they are good at sequestering carbon from seawater, which is something that we need to do. They consume the runoff from things like phosphates in our water supply. So they are making us food while they are cleaning up the ocean, which is also good for the coral and the fish. In terms of sustainability, these shellfish rank up there with seaweed. These mollusks, I sound like I have marbles in my mouth when I try to say that. These fish with the shells, oysters, mussels, clams, and scallops, thrive on microscopic organic matter. But they don't necessarily have to be bottom feeders, like shrimp. So organic waste that ends up in the ocean can be gobbled up by these guys. And then they become delicious food, maybe with a marinara sauce and some nice homemade pasta. Abundanza, as my father would say. That means abundance. May your future be bountiful, is basically how the word is put in a phrase. So the farming of these mussels, clams, oysters, and scallops can be done by lowering ropes into the ocean, and these guys will gobble up the agricultural runoff and cling to the rope, and poof, we have food. Now number five. Number five is another word I'd like to pronounce, and that is legumes. Now, legumes or pulses are usually two terms that are used interchangeably, but they're slightly different. Legumes refers to any plant in the Fabaceae family, and that includes its leaves, stems, and pods. A pulse is the edible seed from a legume plant. For example, a pea pod is a legume, but the pea inside is called the pulse. So pulses are beans, lentils, chickpeas, and green peas. Now there's a type of lentil called mung dal, which has been getting some attention lately, in particular for vegans, because it has 14 grams of protein per cup of cooked and iron and folate. Now these legumes and pulses are cheap, and they are low-fat sources of protein, fiber, vitamins, and minerals. Legumes are usually grown for human consumption, but also for livestock. The stems and leaves can be fed to ruminating animals, like cattle and horses. So the leftover plants, after we take our edible portion, can be fed to cows, horses, lambs, and also omnivores like pigs. And what the animals don't eat can be used for soil-enhancing green manure. In other words, put it back in the soil. And because it's non-GMO and organic, more than likely, it will nourish the soil and allow microorganisms to do their thing. As you probably know, beans, lentils, chickpeas, and green peas are a nutrient-dense food containing just about everything. Now, most experts agree that if we want to save the planet, and I assume we do, we should be eating a lot less red meat and more of these guys. But for right now, if we can raise cattle and lamb on a farm with crop rotation, we can do both. In other words, the livestock can be part of that rotation. They graze and they poop, and that pasture is then used to grow crops the next season. So these legumes would not need artificial fertilizers. Now, I suppose for six, I'll add seaweed and give it its own category, but not too much to say here. It's important for the sustainability of the ocean. Seaweed gobbles up carbon dioxide and reduces the acidity of the ocean, which saves the coral. It also helps other sea life to flourish. And we need that seafood, folks, to feed the 8 billion people that will be living on our planet soon. Seaweed absorbs agricultural runoff because it uses nitrates to grow. The runoff from chemical fertilizers ends up in streams, and that eventually flows to the ocean, which is changing the pH of the ocean. Truthfully, we haven't been paying much attention to all these fertilizers ending up in the ocean. I suppose the scientists have, but we haven't been paying attention to them until recently, of course. So our pollutants are the seaweed's nutrients. Now for number 7, I'm combining two types of foods that can save us on irrigation water. The first group of plants are called the microgreens, which have been getting a lot of attention lately due to the presence of phytochemicals, specifically antioxidants that might be able to fight cancer and possibly even autism. I noticed that broccoli sprouts are in all the major supermarkets now, here in Massachusetts anyway. And that trend will continue. You can also just go to Amazon and order them to be delivered through Whole Foods or order the seeds for delivery. You can sprout the seeds if you happen to have the energy to grow them or teach your kids to grow them, which will make these sprouts very inexpensive and nutritious. You can put all that part-time homeschooling with your kids to good use. It might be a good way to give your kids a step up in the learning process and teach them to value fresh food. The second group of plants that save on water is moringa and similar plants. Moringa is a tree where the leaves, roots, and seeds are edible for people and livestock. Moringa is a nutrient-dense plant originating in India, and its benefits are similar to kale. The difference is that moringa grows well in drought conditions. In other words, doesn't need much water. Even green leafies like kale, spinach, and broccoli require more water. Almonds and avocados require a lot of water. The leaves of moringa are similar to kale in terms of antioxidants and anti-inflammatory compounds. However, when eating the roots or seeds, especially in high-dose concentrated forms, it could have a laxative effect. So FYI on that one. So eating the actual plant is fine, but like many plants, if you do mega doses, it could have some medicinal effect that you may or may not want. The last thing I want to mention that is extremely important is composting our produce. Unlike the composting process that involves worms and microorganisms, dumping rotten food into landfills actually creates more greenhouse gases. Like the case with recycling, I think people can get used to separating their produce scraps from their meat scraps or other rubbish. We can send them off to be composted or do it ourselves. This replenishes the vitamins and flavor compounds in the soil when the compost is used as fertilizer. The experts say we can save emissions by 8% if we recycle our scraps instead of making it garbage in landfills. We could buy chicken on the bone and use the bones in vegetable scraps to make a stock. The skins of the produce, I think we know now, are where the phytonutrients are, so it's good to get them into our body either directly by eating them or putting them into another food. We can also support farmers' markets and other local sustainable companies that make surplus or damaged fruit into condiments. It broke my heart last year to see a mound of potatoes as high as a three-story building that was simply rotting in a landfill because restaurants couldn't use them. Same thing with tomatoes. Those types of food could have easily been made into products to be delivered free of charge because it was basically costing us money to ship them to the landfills. The lesson to be learned there during the pandemic is that with organization, we can recycle what doesn't get used and make it into nutritious food. Okay, so I hope you've gotten something out of this little episode, and maybe it sparks some ideas about what you can do. And you can tell your friends around the water cooler, if there is still such a thing, that we can actually do something to make our food more sustainable, to slow down climate change, and eat healthy at the same time. And as Smokey the Bear once said, only you can prevent forest fires. Only you and me and other like-minded people can do something individually to save our planet, so we can take a similar approach to eating sustainably. You are one beautiful person on this beautiful planet that we need to rescue. We can all do this together. That's all I have for you today. Be well, and stay tuned next week for another episode of Healing Outside the Box.